Union Broadcast Center. I'm GoLocal News editor Kate Nagel. I'd like to welcome in my next guest, GoLocal columnist Bob Whitcomb.
Hello, Kate.
Thanks for joining us to cap off the week here and talk all about news and politics. And the big news last night, finally at City Council, after much ado, the City Council overrode Mayor Jorge Alorza's veto of the variance. Now, this is simply the height variance for Jason Fain's proposed 46-story tower.
That's the crucial thing, is the height. So, I mean, that's the distinguishing thing. I should chime in. We don't really know what the final design is.
We absolutely do not.
I mean, this is the ziggurat thing, which I think is very entertaining, actually. But the final one, I don't know. I think what this does suggest, the mayor will not be allowed to be the architect on it. I wouldn't be surprised if our old friend Friedrich St. Florian has something to do with the final design.
Maybe have some input, because it does have to go through the design review. I mean, this was a big hurdle.
Yeah.
Obviously, the opponents had come out en masse. Mary Kay Harris was the big deciding vote.
I know, Kay. Under tremendous pressure. She almost seemed in tears about it. And it was actually more lopsided than I thought it would. Were you surprised? I was a little bit surprised. It was speaking my
mind. There was some interesting commentary after the fact that it was, if you know you have the votes, don't filibuster your own vote. But I think that Councilwoman Harris really felt the need to explain her vote
because I admire her for that.
She was under so much pressure from both sides, and I think that's why she brought out the.
They didn't want a $300 million thing. Yeah, they get tax breaks as everybody else does. I think the more interesting thing, if it does get built, who will live there? Will there be a lot of flight capitalists there who aren't there most of the time? They just want a property, a kind of money laundering operation. Will there be a lot of parents of Brown and RISD students who buy places, maybe even buy places
the
for their
college
kids?
College wealth industrial complex.
Yeah, the college industrial, the Ivy League industrial complex.
Well, I'll tell you this.
We don't know that, but it'll go up in if it gets built, maybe 3 years, something like that? We don't know what anything's going to look like in three
years.
I do know this broadcast will be in Serbo-Croatian. It's part of GoLocal's outreach.
We'll have it in 100 different languages.
That's right.
No, just this week it was announced residential properties, a team there had just closed on the largest sale this year of a two-bedroom condo in Water Place. So, there's some talk about what the market is. Is it cooling? Is it not? But there was just a big sale from a two-bedroom.
Cooling, apparently, it's cooling in New York fast. It might be part of the tax law. It might have something to do with it, which is against the Northeast in California. And some cooling going on in Boston. The New York cooling is quite clear.
Well, we'll see. Yeah. We'll continue to follow the next steps for the Fain Tower. Let's talk a little bit about the economy here in Rhode Island, Bob. I had the opportunity to have House Finance Chair Marvin Abney in yesterday. At the latest, about 2 or 3 weeks ago now, House Finance met, projected $42 million shortfall for the current fiscal year, a projected $112. I mean, that one looking out to FY20 can change very quickly. But it seems like we're always sort of in this boat.
Yeah, is this due to a slowing economy around here, sort of a somewhat sluggish economy? I'd like to know more of the reasons for that. Is this overspending, bad budgeting? Do they need new computers? Maybe we should hire the people who did the benefits thing. That was exciting.
No, that was one of the things we talked about, was state government and the need for departments to look at their spending.
This gets to something I want to mention. I put a little item about this in my little column about Springfield, Massachusetts, which they went under a control board in 2004, and they've really made huge progress. They have a good mayor. They know where the money is going in each department very clearly, and I think there may be some lessons there. Springfield, boring old Springfield, famous for two things now. Casino is the birthplace of who? Dr. Seuss.
Birthplace of Dr. Seuss.
And basketball. And Dr. Seuss, much more important.
Dr. Seuss, basketball.
And other infantile games, right. So anyway, I think there's some lessons. People could look it up. I think I found this in Governing magazine.
Do you think it could be applied to the state level?
I think state level and city level.
Very interesting.
Thoughtful piece.
It on Sunday. One of the things that I talked about with the chairman as well was clearly they'll be taking a look at the Rhode Island Promise Program. Of course, when the governor introduced it, it was, there were no results. You couldn't see where it was
based on the Tennessee thing, wasn't it?
Very similar to the Tennessee thing. But now we're getting some numbers. But as GoLocal reported, they counted the entire cohort of entering students as their Rhode Island Promise students.
This we should tell everybody, the CCRI.
CCRI, right?
What we used to call junior college.
But they didn't break out who was getting the free college, yeah, and then how they were performing. Were they meeting expectations? It was, you know, Chairman Abney made very clear that he wants real numbers, not the entire, oh, they're all our promised students. It'll be very interesting to see when the governor, if she does, propose the expansion that she had promised during the campaign.
That will be very interesting, and how she can put this in national comparative context. My own view on this is it's very early. These things, like fixing education in general, you've got to kind of run through the boa constrictor. You know, it takes a while to digest.
Move it through.
And I don't think we're going to really have that clear idea of how well this program is working for a couple of years. I'm not defending the governor or attacking him. I'm just saying these things take a lot of time.
So do you think that the expansion should be put on hold while we
wait
and see
how... I think you keep going and
give it
a couple of years. I think it's an exciting idea. The central problem, that it's not the taxes are too high. The central problem, we don't have enough qualified people. That's the central problem. I've been told this by business executives back when I was the business editor. That's the crucial thing. It's not taxes. Everybody everywhere whines about taxes. And taxes should be streamlined. They should be made clearer. They probably could be made fair. We have a property tax problem here, which has to be adjusted. But
education clearly is always the tops of the list. And I think it was after we had you in last week, we had Neil Steinberg from the Rhode Island Foundation. They convened a group of stakeholders to look at it. 10-year
plan. Or steak
plan.
Eaters, maybe.
Steak eaters.
In Providence, many fine restaurants.
Steak eaters, stakeholders. He said, you know, it needs 10 years. And my question to him is, why can't you just grab that Massachusetts blueprint and not go through the
grunt pains of
data?
We know it works. And I have watched
this,
that. That took
this.
A long while, too, to fully kick in. But when that started under Weld, I think, and then under Republican and Democratic governors, it's been pressed, and they've wrote, now I would never believe this. Massachusetts now has arguably the best public schools in the country, which is extraordinary because it's a complex urban state, very heterogeneous, and yet all over the state, obviously the best public schools tend to be in the, you know, the affluent suburbs of Boston, but still all over the state, poor towns, rich towns, and so on, there's been major improvement. You know, whatever the demography of the locality and the school district, and there's clearly a great model there. The other thing, besides the fact it's a good model, is that we, in the long run, in Rhode Island, have to follow what they do because they're so much bigger and richer. In the end, our policies, while there's a lag time, are made in Beacon Hill, not Smith Hill.
Well,
that's the way it should be, because this shouldn't be a state. That's
the Commissioner of Education in Massachusetts at the time when these reforms were implemented is actually on that panel with the Rhode Island Foundation.
Great.
So I guess
Neil hired him then?
Neil brought him in and said, we need to pick your brain. Neil was good. He had plenty of answers for when, you know, do we really need 10 years? But he said, that's the goal when we can work back.
Yeah.
And that's not to preclude advancements being made day in, day out.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think the question is, you know, we're up there with Mass. We're, you know, top 10 in the country for per pupil spending.
Right.
Are there going to be suggestions that say, taxpayers, we need more, but when we've already been spending so much
and getting... How can this be changed in terms of labor contracts and more flexibility? Should the charter school movement be expanded? I mean, my friend Ed Acorn over the Providence Journal is always talking of charter schools. That may be part of the package, but I think major improvements must be made every year.
Yes.
But we cannot expect a huge triumphant Nobel Peace Prize triumph.
Overnight, no.
Overnight.
No,
it's gonna take. I mean, you figure K through 12, that's a lot of grades right there. Then 2 years for junior college or community college, and then 2 more years for college, and then a vocational element. So I think we're talking about 10 years.
Yeah.
But that's no excuse not to keep
pushing
hard. Whoever gets elected next time around.
Let's talk about another big issue facing the state, and I believe you said you're going to write about it, the fate of Hasbro.
Yeah, Hasbro. My concern about Hasbro is the politicians could be jumping all over themselves to give stuff to Hasbro. Well, what we should be doing is stuff that we should be doing infrastructure, education, tax streamlining, regulations that helps everybody. So what we do, this happens in every state and city in the country. They go after the headline name, the sexy name. That's one of the few really famous companies that's based here. And then give them the stars, the moon, and the sky. But everybody else has to pay for it, so they become less competitive.
Part of the problem, too, is the fact that it does reside...
It's sexy.
It's sexy, and it coincides with the fate of Pawtucket, which, right. I mean, it's the perfect storm.
You know what Pawtucket should be? Pawtucket should be pressing for more and more rail service. They should make a big deal about the new railroad station.
And I think they're trying.
Higher speed rail, and then Pawtucket can become part of Boston, basically.
Put it on the
cheaper place to live. They still have wonderful old lofts and stuff, and you know, sort of an adjunct to Boston, and which they could do if they get faster and more frequent train service. Commercially, I don't see any big company staying in or moving in Pawtucket. I don't think it's
Hasbro has its own set of issues, as we've seen. Their performance by lieu of the clothing.
Amazon's going to get in the toy business.
Amazon's getting in the toy business, and the Hasbro stock just went, you know, plummeted talk of this happening. So,
I mean, it's an entertainment company now, too. It's not really a manufacturer. It's an entertainment
company. A lot
company.
Of online.
So what do you think? Two words, Southern California.
Yeah.
Or maybe New York City.
No, that's they have talked about the West Coast.
So, I mean, I love Hasbro. I've had friends over there over the years. I've covered it. But I just hope they don't give away the store and then send everybody else the bill.
So, while we still have you here in studio, and you've got some notes, what
before
else can we...
Before the police show up.
What else can we expect from
this
weekend?
Okay, well, I talk about Hasbro, as you know. And I talk about this, speaking of innovation stuff, the innovation center that's setting up in Newport, which I think it could work pretty well because they've got the Naval Undersea Warfare Center.
A lot of brain power.
War College, Raytheon, a lot of small, medium-sized engineering and tech companies. And I think conceivably, especially because Newport's such an interesting place to live, that could be, in the fullness of time, be a lot bigger than the 33,000-square-foot center they're setting up. At the same time, I also comment about how innovation is overrated. Sometimes innovation doesn't make things better, it makes things worse, like a cell phone. Well, we all have our cell phones, and they're very handy in emergency, but it also breeds attention deficit disorder.
The decline of humanity,
as we know
about
social media. We know about a catastrophe that could be.
Well, these laws
for national security.
Of unintended consequences, that is for sure.
So I talk about that, and I talk about water pollution. As you know, the Trump administration wants to weaken the water regulations. I sort of make a connection there. We have wonderful marshes. The Providence Journal, give them credit, they did a nice piece about the marsh grass down the Narrow River. Well, if they loosen some of these rules, it's going to kill some more marshes, as the marshes are going underwater anyway, increasingly. So I don't like that. So I want people to, you know, chime in on that. That's something that the Trump administration can almost do in its own because it's, I believe, a regulation, not a law.
Okay.
And who wants this? Guess who? Agribusiness, the coal miners, and so on. And let me see, do we have time for, like, Oatsy Charles?
Oatsy Charles.
Great socialite. She died at age 98, I think. GoLocal broke the story. She's one of the last kind of the doyens, the queens of high society. And, you know, the world of the movie High Society from the 1956 set in Newport, you know, with music, words and music by the poet laureate of that crowd, who was Cole Porter, obviously. So she is, by all accounts, a nice lady, resilient lady. The passing of her reminds me of the old WASP Society is declining. And new people are coming in, Silicon Valley money, and so on. And I say, well, the new crowd, they're more informal, they're more impatient, their manners aren't as good, but they're less bigoted.
Okay. So hitting the nail on the head.
That's right.
Well, Bob, as always, appreciate you taking the time to come here into the studio. We'll see you next week, and we'll be back with our next guest here, so don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.